Hi there and welcome to Central Texas Gardener. I'm Tom Spencer. Like anything else, gardening comes with a learning curve, and believe me, I'm still learning. But to save you some time, today designer Colleen Dieter shares her top list of garden mistakes. Like me, she learned the hard way, from experience. So we gathered these tips to make it easier for you. On tour, we visit a new gardener who is just getting started when we taped this.
After new homeowner Brent Henry became a new gardener as well, he enlisted designer Wendy Lovejoy to finesse the work he'd already done.
First year I was working inside the house. I didn't have time to work out in the garden, so it was a year of making the house the way I wanted it to be and letting the garden suffer somewhat because it's not the priority at the time.
But it was hard to stay inside when the view outside was what had attracted him in the first place.
I saw when I bought the house, I saw the beauty that the house had with the green belt, and I knew that gardening would only make that experience better.
The trees were another selling point, but their density meant research into plants for shade most of the day. Brent took advantage of one sunny spot to plant earth-kind roses. Then he replaced the lawn in that section with crushed granite walkways that define his travels from shade to sun.
Crushed granite was something that I grew up as a kid. Our family ranch had Sandy Creek running through it, and essentially all the soil around there is crushed granite, so it's a material that came natural for me. It's something I always enjoyed. I like the look, it's easy to work with.
To tie the patio into the granite's warm tones, Brent tiled over the concrete pad. He used stone vertically too, in a fountain that substitutes for a pond.
I got all the sound and the look without the size. After work, I'd like to sit out in the porch area, and my view going out to the green belt is already very beautiful with the green belt and the trees. So I just tried to add other features into the space that makes it more relaxing for me.
Opposite the granite, he's kept a cove of lawn to offset borders and pocket plantings. A season at a time, he widens the beds. One goal was to break up the static runway next to the house.
And it's more pleasing for me to see the curved lines as opposed to the straight lines.
But as much as he's learned in just a few years, Brent decided he needed a mentor to put it all into perspective.
His passion's plants, and he's very good at bringing in different plants and adventurous, I would say, at trying new things. But I believe he needed help just in bringing it all together so that his yard would flow, that there would be some rhyme and reason to it. What you do is you just extend what you have. For example, he had a small patio. We extended that out with the decomposed granite and extended it further with the walkways. So it's no longer choppy. You have this flow coming from the back door to the gate. Same with the gardens. If you have a small garden bed, you might want to extend that out until it meets where you want your lawn to be or where you want your hard surface to be. So you don't want choppy, you just, you know, just bring extend everything out and bring it together and connect the spaces. It's real easy to go to the nursery and pick out one of every plant that you like, and then when you bring it home to try to put that together is a little difficult. So one thing I encouraged him to do was if he found one plant he liked, to get many, you know, 5, 7, and mass them together.
Grouping plants also defined boundaries, inviting an exclusive connection to each garden room. Structural accents focus attention as well. Brent took advantage of a tree to sponsor discovery between spaces, reinforcing it with hanging ferns to separate the grassy cove and the patio view. In front, Brent gave the yard a personable good look for the neighborhood without a lot of tending.
I don't spend that much time in the front, so I try to have something a little more static, much more easy to keep. I did want to keep a little bit of lawn for now, as just because I don't have the time and the money to increase the beds.
In the meantime, he works in small doses, learning about plants for sun. For the hot strip along the curb, designing a tough, low water attraction has been as challenging as dealing with the shade and back. At the front porch, Brent added another fountain. He's learned how the details, from architecture to plants, make such a difference in a garden's design.
It is hard, and that's why you need to kind of plan on what you want to put in the beds. It's not something you just, a lot of people like to do, just go out and buy a plant and put it in their beds, but you have to have a little of a plan.
Now there's somebody who's really put the gardening ABCs together, which is exactly what we're going to be doing right now. I'm joined by Colleen Dieter from redwheelbarrowplants.com. Red Wheelbarrow is the name of your company. You do design and maintenance. And welcome back to Central Texas Gardener.
Thanks for having me. I'm so glad to be back.
Well, you know, the topic we've selected today is a great one for so many people out there. And it, basically, it's kind of learning from mistakes, right?
That's right. Right, and hopefully we can give some encouragement to new gardeners today to help them avoid some of the mistakes that, you know, veteran gardens have made. Exactly.
Now, if you're a veteran gardener, you've made plenty of mistakes. And you and I were just talking, and I was confessing to a few.
That's right.
It does happen.
Things that we have in common.
Right. But, and this is... You know, this is one of the things I love about the gardening community is people are anxious to share both their successes and what's gone wrong. And we hope to steer people toward those successes right now. Mm-hmm. And what are some of the things that you find are the most common mistakes that people fall in love with gardening, but they often make the same mistakes? There's some common kind of... dead ends that people take.
Right. Yeah. Well, the first thing I want to say is that it's really important for people to remember to have fun and to remember that it's relatively low stakes.
Yeah.
You know, to not get too caught up with keeping up with the Joneses.
Exactly.
You know, to try to just have a good time with it and to remember that, you know, the things that we're saying on the show today are just tips, you know, things to be helpful, but they're also just that you don't have to feel anxious about doing something wrong or making huge mistakes or something like that.
I'm so glad you said that because so often I meet people who are nearly desperate. And they get wound up about it and then they start to overdo everything.
Exactly. And I started doing gardening coaching recently. So I'll go to people's homes and help them, give them advice. And so often I run into marital disputes over plants. And I just feel like, gosh, you know, it's important to just make sure you're having a good time and not fight about things and keep it on the light side. So that's one thing I just want to preface our conversation with.
So I'm glad you did that. It should be a joy.
Yeah, but probably one of the number one problems I see, especially with beginning gardeners, is that they'll plant the plants a little too low. And that happens really often in Austin, I think, because sometimes you'll read something from a source that has to do with gardening in the north.
Right.
And often, sometimes up there, it's recommended that things are planted low to protect them from the cold.
Frost, right.
But we don't have that problem here. And what will happen here is if you plant a plant too low in the ground and then pile mulch up around it or pile gravel up around it, it can cause the stems to rot.
Right.
So that can become a problem.
And when we say plant low, what we're talking about is, say you bring home a plant from a nursery, the level of the soil in the container it's low if it's below the surface of the soil.
That's right. Yeah, it should be flush with the soil in the
or
container.
Or even maybe, I'll tell people, just on the safe side, maybe half an inch or an inch above the level.
That's what I always tell people, too, a little bit high, because then...
when it settles.
Because it's going to settle, because our soil here is clay,
and
it expands and contracts a lot. And when it expands and contracts, it's going to, the plant will sink a little bit.
Yeah.
So you're right about that.
So planting plants a little bit high or at level is a recommendation there. So that's a good tip.
Yeah.
What are some of the other mistakes you see people making? I've been guilty of this a million times. I see a plant in the nursery, it's got a striking form or color, and I'm just like, I want it.
Yeah.
And I've made the commitment even before I've read the tag.
Right. Yeah. It's easy to become bewitched and to fall in love with a plant, you know. One thing that I tell people who are just starting out is that it's a good idea to try to buy plants in threes. So if you see a plant that you really like that, maybe think about buying three of them so that you have a group of them in your yard. And a lot of times I'll go to yards and I'll find people who just are plant collectors, you know, and that's something where they'll go to the nursery and they'll see, you know, plants that they just love, and they'll buy one of every plant that they really, really love. And then, and that can look nice.
It can,
but
rarely
it
does.
Would look, it would look nicer if you had groups of plants together.
I think that's a great tip for design, and repetition counts.
Yeah, and that's important. Now, occasionally, the exception to that rule is if you see a really striking plant with an interesting form or something like that that you want to use as a focal point. You know, that's an exception to that rule. But in general, it's better to plant in masses so it doesn't look as hodgepodged.
What about watering?
So it's really easy in Austin, surprisingly, to overwater. And this is one mistake that I made when I first moved here from Ohio. I thought, oh my God, it is so hot here. How could you ever overwater anything? And so I would go out to my garden every day and water and water and water and water. And then I noticed things starting to turn yellow, starting to not look so great, and realized that I actually was overwatering them. And that, again, is because of the clay soil that we have here. And clay...
A lot of people have clay.
Yeah,
Some people don't.
A lot of people have clay soil here. And you'll know if you have clay, because if you go to dig a hole... And the soil's moist at all, it'll stick to your shovel, and it'll stick to your hands. It's like almost like Play-Doh.
Yeah.
So that kind of soil can just really hold a lot of water for a long time.
A long time.
So really, it reminds me of when I was in college, one of my horticulture professors said, this is the best tool that you have to measure whether you need to water or not. Put your finger in the soil.
Right.
And actually... feel it to determine if it's wet or not. The other thing that happens sometimes is that plants, it gets so hot here in the summer, sometimes the plants will wilt even if there's enough water in the soil. They just can't take the water up fast enough because it's so hot outside.
Yeah.
So they'll look wilty in the afternoons, but then when the sun goes down or starts to set, they'll perk up a little bit.
You know, watch the plants and pay a little bit of attention. You know, a lot of times, as you say, those signs of stress will disappear even if a cloud goes over.
Yeah, exactly. Just something, a little bit of shelter. Yeah,
right.
It'll perk back up again.
And irrigation systems, common mistakes made with irrigation systems all the time.
Yeah, so that's a difficult one. You know, so often I'll get a new customer or someone that I'm going to coach, and they know that they have an irrigation system because we can see the heads in the yard, but they often don't even know where the control box is or how to operate it. And they're daunting. You know, they are kind of complicated machines
to use. Sometimes it can be,
And so it's important, you know, to get advice about that. Or a lot of times you can look on the internet and find the manuals on the internet of how to use your irrigation control box. Because a lot of times what happens is, when a landscape is first put in, the irrigation is set to run every day to water new plants, plants that have just been put in. But then, as time goes on, the plants get established and they don't need that much water anymore. but the irrigation is still running that way all the time, and it never gets switched to a lower setting.
Or people make the mistake of, you know, purposely setting the irrigation to run for a brief time every day. And it barely gets the leaves wet. And it evaporates without really doing anything.
Yeah, and then it just wastes your water. And so it's a good idea to water less frequently for a long period of time.
Right.
So that the water can soak into the ground as deep as possible.
Right. Yeah. Now, I really love what you when you were giving design tips because about buying plants in groups, and I also like the fact that you mentioned odd numbers because it has more of a naturalistic feel when you put three plants in to a landscape, or five plants or seven plants. There's just something that works about that in more natural kind of plant settings. Any other design tips or things about organizing garden spaces for people?
One thing that I come across frequently is people who want to use a lot of straight lines in their gardens and their yards. So they'll build a square flower bed in front of their house, you know, and to me, that's appropriate in some situations if you have a particularly grand kind of European style house. But in general, in Austin, if you have a typical kind of Texas house, like my house is a little ranch house, you know, it's more appropriate to add some curvy lines to kind of contrast like the squareness of the house. And Texas is just easygoing, you know, it's an easygoing landscape and people are relaxed and easygoing. So making things curved, putting beds in curved lines and then groups of plants helps a lot.
All great tips. Colleen Dieter, again, your company is Red Wheelbarrow, and it's redwheelbarrowplants.com.
That's right.
People can find you on the web that way. I think we did a pretty good job
in
a low-key way of helping people get started on the right foot and avoid some mistakes.
So I hope so.
I appreciate you being along.
All right.
And good luck to you and your plant coaching. I love that concept.
Thank you so much.
All right.
I appreciate it.
Okay, coming up next, it's Skip Richter.
Hello and welcome to Down to Earth. This week's question regards, how do I plant tomatoes for fall? Well, the best way to do it, you can certainly start seeds and do it the traditional way, but for fall, the best way is to tip root your tomato plants. Tomatoes are vines, and as they produce long shoots, those shoots can be bent over to the ground and either placed underneath the ground with the end sticking out or put into a container, such as a gallon pot with some potting soil in it. You just need part of the vine to be down underneath the soil and it will root. As you can see in the photo, tomatoes want to root everywhere that their vines touch the ground and stay moist. And that's the other key, to keep that spot where the vine is underground wet. Once it starts rooting, which only takes a week or two, then you can cut them away from the mother plant, destroy the mother plant along with all the mites and aphids and everything else that have taken it down, and your new plant is started and ready to go. If you do it in a container, you can just move it somewhere else and plant it. It's really easy to do, and it's a great way to get a fast start for a fall tomato crop. Our featured plant this week is tropical milkweed, also called Mexican milkweed. This is an annual that's sometimes perennial in our climates when we have a very, very warm winter. It's one that grows right through the heat just perfectly well. It's one of my favorite plants to grow in the garden. It does reseed and comes up here and there as the seeds float along like other milkweeds. But the tropical milkweed is typically a yellow or an orange flower, but there's a yellow form also if you like. It attracts butterflies. In fact, it's a larval food source for the monarch butterfly. It's extremely tough, able to take drought and come right back and do just well. It blooms on through the heat, so we don't have to worry a lot about pampering it in our central Texas climate. Tropical milkweed does attract a yellow aphid, but you don't need to worry about those. There are so many beneficial insects that come to that. In fact, it's a nursery for rearing beneficial insects. Let those yellow aphids get on it, and you'll soon find the ladybugs, the lacewings, surfid fly larvae, also called hoverflies, will be there on it, and parasitic wasps attack them too. In fact, it's very interesting for children to go turn the leaves over and look at all the different critters crawling around on it and learn a lot about beneficial insects. When you see the little aphids turning from yellow to brown, they have a parasitic wasp inside. So another good reason to plant this, not just in your flower garden, but among your vegetables too, because as you raise those beneficials, then they go around and help take care of the aphids on your tomatoes and crepe myrtles and other things. Out in the garden, it's time to shear those things that are going to bloom in the fall if they're a little bit out of shape. For example, the Mexican mint marigold can be sheared now. You can also shear some of the fall asters. Those bushes tend to grow a little bit irregular. They don't require shearing, but if you want to shape them a little, now's the time to do it because they need time to regrow and then set blooms for fall. Check your fruit trees for scale. Scale can build up during the summer. A little squirt of summer oil directed right at the scale can help shut that down. Any vegetables that like the heat can still be planted, so we can be putting out okra. It's probably still time to get in some winter squash as well. Malabar spinach and amaranth can still be planted now, so hot weather vegetables can continue to go in, as well as flowers that like the heat. The Madagascar periwinkle, for example, is a good one to plant this time of year. You can even start to plant some marigolds, and they'll do quite well in the fall. Check your crepe myrtles for aphids. You know they build up on those and tend to create a honeydew that we want to get rid of. They're easy to take care of as well. For more tips to get in touch with the Extension office in your area, visit klru.org/ctg.
Thanks, Skip. Now let's check in with Trisha Shirey for Backyard Basics.
It doesn't seem to matter how carefully I plan the garden. Every year it seems like I have a surplus of some vegetable, and this year was the year of the cucumber. I only planted three varieties and two plants of each of those three varieties, but it seemed like I was picking buckets and buckets of cucumbers every week. And I did cucumber soup and salads, and but there's only really so many cucumbers you can eat before you have just way too many. And my friend Javier suggested that I make aguas frescas. And it was such a great idea that pretty soon I didn't have too many cucumbers because I was using them for this wonderful drink. Now, in Mexico, they're often sold by street vendors, and they are a mixture of many different things. Sometimes you'll find aguas frescas made with cucumbers, sometimes with melons, cantaloupes, and they're very, very simple to make, and they use a lot of produce in the making. So with aguas frescas and cucumbers, you don't really have to peel the cucumber. Now, if you're using cucumbers from your own garden, these are some of the cucumbers that I did really well with, the regular green type cucumbers. Market Moore and Diva are two really good varieties for this area. But I also grow a lot of these lemon cucumbers, and they're really best small. This very large one is getting to be a little bit too mature to eat in salads, but it still makes a wonderful agua fresca. The seeds inside are fairly large at that point. But you don't have to peel them again if your cucumbers are homegrown and not waxed to make this. And so what you'll do is just cut your cucumbers up kind of chunky. It doesn't really have to be a very small dice or anything like that. And you'll put them in a blender. And I think a blender is really better than a food processor for this. And put them in a blender, cover them over with good quality water, and just blend. I first start with a low speed, a grate, and then progressively blend until they're fairly thoroughly blended. And then you'll take that blender and strain through a fairly fine strainer. You want a strainer that is going to catch most of the pulp. And so put that in, and you don't want to press it through the strainer. Just let it strain out and very gradually. Now, many times in aguas frescas, other things are added. You can add some fresh lime, some fresh lemon. Sometimes I'll chop up some fresh mint along with the cucumber, and that's really refreshing. You can also add sweetener. sweetener if you like. Now, I think for the cucumbers, you really don't need the sweetener, but you could add agave nectar, rice syrup, sugar, whatever sweetener you like. And another thing that really works well with aguas frescas is sometimes you'll have melons, cantaloupes, watermelon that are really too sweet and not really all that great a flavor. So you could make a melon or a watermelon agua fresca, add a little sweetener to it, maybe even a little mint, and it makes a really nice beverage, and you get to take advantage of using that produce. So just strain this through your strainer. You can give it a little bit of a shake to get most of the water out. That contents go into your compost pile, and then keep it in the refrigerator for up to a day or two. It's really refreshing to come back in from the garden after a tough morning working and have a wonderful ice-cold glass of cucumber agua fresca. And if you want an adult beverage, add a little vodka or tequila to it as well. I hope you'll enjoy aguas frescas from your garden.
Check out klru.org/ctg for more tips, online video, and our weekly blog. Until next week, I'll see you in the garden.
Visit klru.org/ctg to learn more about today's program, upcoming events, and to sign up for our electronic newsletter. Check out John's how-to tips and visit Trisha's Corner for ideas inside and out. Get growing at klru.org/ctg.